So my talk is Traditional Marriage and Sexual Morality, a Defense, and I actually began this about a year and a half ago. There was something happened. And anyway, though, Moreland, J.P. Moreland, some of you might know, he's one of the world's leading Christian philosophers of mind, has actually endorsed this model now, which is kind of cool. So let's begin here. So here's some of the, is there some way to make this larger on the, so I can read it better? I'll just read it here. So basically, these are some of the extremist consequences of attacking marriage. One example would be there's an academic conference in Baltimore, Maryland in 2011 that was aiming to normalize pedophilia as an orientation, normalization of gender identity disorder as an orientation as well. We've seen that much more recently now with, say, the Bruce Jenner thing. Push for legalizing polygamy. They actually want to open the door to polygamous marriage now, which is the, you've seen several articles of that. Another thing, this is a different sort of area, Common Core curriculum is promoting wide range of deviancy to school children, and some of these are even in grade school. So of course people were, you know, we would bring these up and say, you know, we attack marriage and all this is going to happen, and they would say, well, this is just a slippery slope fallacy, and well, we can see that obviously it didn't pan out. It was all kind of a ruse to begin with. So anyway, the bottom line is you need to have marriage to have a sexual morality. It doesn't make, it turns into a complete free-for-all without that framework. So here's an example of a YouTube atheist. This is what the kind of the millennial generation is going with this. They have like no framework on sexual morality whatsoever, and it's really starting to decay the culture. He said, this is why I love non-theistic Levian Satanism so much, is because it encourages people to express all forms of their sexuality in forms without any shame, as long as that sexual expression does not harm anyone. Now, he means here by does not harm equals consent, which in other words means any consensual perversion you can imagine. So it's basically a complete free-for-all. All right, so the problem with defending this, though, is, well, marriage is seen as a religious construct, and if you want to talk about politics, you have to provide a secular argument. And so we have the situation of, you know, we need to defend, in order to defend sexual morality, we need to do it on with seeming religion, but we can't do it with religion because you need a rational argument. And, you know, we oftentimes, people will provide secular type arguments with consequences and so on, but these are relatively easy to dismiss or dismantle from a secularist frame of reference. So here's some examples. Here's sexual vices. Pornography usage, that gives high divorce rates, almost 50% divorce rate. Promiscuity or polyamory, that spreads STDs, homosexuality, high rate of AIDS. Premarital sex, high abortion rate, and no-fault divorce, you have various social ills. You know, kids growing up into delinquents and so on. And people will say, you know, this doesn't really matter, these are just risks taken with an activity, right? You can do whatever you want, and people already take risks. You know, you drive a car on the road, there's a chance to get a car accident, just like there's a chance to get an STD or so on. And so that really is an argument, they'll say. Or they'll say that there are other rights, like right to divorce trumps the right to what will happen to the kids, or they'll say abortion is a right, and so on. And so the trouble here is when we try and use consequential arguments, they don't really work. You can't really argue from the consequences and say, therefore, these things are bad. You can try, but they'll, at the end of the day, be relatively easy to dismantle. And so now, that means we kind of have to go to the basic reason for it. So in Ephesians 5:32, Paul describes marriage as a great mystery, as an image of Christ in the church. So it seems the real argument for traditional marriage is tied up in a great mystery, a religious great mystery. So it looks like we're stuck. The only way to defend a moderate position against sexual extremism is a religious great mystery, which is not accessible to everyone. So what do we do? Well, we solve the mystery. We make it accessible to everybody. So to make the reason for traditional marriage and thus sexual morality accessible to everyone, we need to defend the position on rational grounds rather than just religious grounds. And well, the problem with this is people often have, I mean, most people who are religious are substance dualists. And along with that, that entails that there is a supernatural world of faith that can only be known by faith and is inaccessible to reason, and there is a material world you know through reason. And so, therefore, when you go into politics, any, you know, spiritual reasons have to be thrown out because they cannot be accessed rationally in the public arena. Fortunately, idealism doesn't have this dichotomy. There's just one substance on idealism, and curiously, that makes it such that what you would call the supernatural or the spiritual then becomes accessible through reason, and you can now form a bridge to argue these things to someone who would not be religious. But first, to do this, we need to see how idealism affects ethics, and that brings us to our first video.
In 2013, the Pew Research Center conducted a survey on global views of morality. What was found was that the countries often described as secular or irreligious were consistently more morally deficient in category after category when compared to their non-secular counterparts. As is apparent, the statistical results of the Pew survey seem to reinforce the stereotype that atheists are immoral. But the question remains, what explains the data? What caused the more non-secular cultures to have better moral views? And why are so many secular cultures unable to be good without God? To answer these questions, we must first look at what is needed to ground objective morality, and in turn, how that relates to a religious or spiritual view of the world. It is often argued by atheists or secularists that the fact that values are subjective undermines objective morality. Morality then becomes merely an opinion, and opinions may differ.
The fact is that morality is not objective. It has no existence outside of minds, outside of personal perspectives.
Good is a point of view, anyway.
Given then that value is subjective, to ground objective morality, we need to find a value set that is universally intersubjective. To do this is simple enough if we first examine the nature of consciousness with respect to the rest of reality. As I have pointed out in other videos, we can doubt the external material world, but not our own mind. Thus, our mind cannot be a material substance, and yet the interaction problem rules out substance dualism. Thus, only mental substance can exist, and idealism is necessarily true. This is, of course, corroborated by finds in modern physics, such as quantum non-realism, and the discovery that the weirdnesses of modern physics resemble information processing effects in virtual realities. Therefore, everything, including our minds and our values, are contained within God's mind. Since we have concepts of value, and our minds are generated by God's mind, it follows that all senses of value derive from God's sense of value as well. Thus, it follows that God's sense of value is universally intersubjective. This follows not out of some divine command theory, but rather out of logical necessity. Our concepts of goodness could not exist were it not for God's sense of goodness. Thus, no sense of goodness could be logically consistent were it not ultimately aligned with God's sense of goodness, as it would ultimately contradict the reality in which it exists. Therefore, alignment with God's sense of goodness, and thus with God's will, would be objectively good, and misalignment with it would be objectively bad. In turn, this brings us to our first parallel between idealist philosophy and theology. Within religious terminology, this concept of being aligned with God's will is commonly referred to by such terms as purity or holiness. For instance, the epistles describe God's will for man as to be holy. For this is God's will, that you become holy. 1 Thessalonians 4:3. Conversely, the Psalms define purity as alignment with God's concept of goodness. How can a young man keep his way pure? By keeping your word. Psalm 119:9. Of course, this concept is by no means unique to an idealist philosophy. However, as we will see shortly, a unique clue emerges that does have a special bearing on idealist philosophy. If we naively assume reality to be external and mind-independent, then it would seem that morality would boil down to a set of external actions complying with a set of external rules. After all, this is how we commonly conceive of our actions. A child is seen as good if he obeys a set of rules given by his parents. An employee is seen as good if she adheres to the policies set by the company. And so, one would naively expect that alignment with God would reduce to mere compliance with externally given rules. However, this is not the case. To see why this is not the case, we need to examine how the individual mind relates to both God and the rest of reality. When we do this, it becomes apparent that both are not merely simple objects in some external world. Firstly, we find that what we call physical spacetime is emergent from entangled quantum information. In turn, from Tononi's integrated information theory, we know that entangled information is necessarily integrated, and thus comprises a conscious state. Thus it follows that physical space-time emerges from a conscious state at a deeper layer of reality. This deeper layer of reality is what is termed the pleroma in Neoplatonist philosophy. Interestingly, this concept also shows up in a religious context. For it was the Father's good pleasure for all the fullness to dwell in him. Colossians 1:19. The Greek for the term fullness here also happens to be pleroma, and this is further fleshed out in the context just two verses earlier. In him all things hold together. Colossians 1:17. Here, the physical creation is held together within the larger reality of the interior of God's mind. The pleroma of verse 19. The question then becomes how we as human souls relate to God and the world in this picture. In my video, Through a Mirror Darkly, I point out that according to the emerging field of quantum cognition, the thoughts, desires, and emotions of our inner space can be modeled mathematically as behaving exactly like wave functions in an abstract Hilbert space. Furthermore, quantum effects such as gamma synchrony in the brain corroborate this through experiment. Yet space-time emerges from quantum information in the wave function. Thus we can think of the pleroma as both the domain of the wave functions behind space-time, but also the realm of our inner state. Thus the pleroma can be seen as a shared inner space hosted by a universal mind. Without emerges from within. All of this can be corroborated through introspection. As pointed out before, the mind is immaterial, and yet dualism is incoherent. Thus idealism is true, and the universe is necessarily a mental construct generated by God's thoughts. But naturally, what generates the world must also come prior to it. However, you already know this. Ideas, such as the forms your mind interacts with, like the number 2, or the idea of the color red, are not located in space and time. This being the case, aligning with God cannot be the same as simply externally complying with a set of rules imposed from the outside. Rather, since one interacts with God in this shared inner space, alignment with God involves one's inner state. Curiously, once this is recognized, a whole host of parallels begin to emerge in theology. In religion, the concept of holiness or purity is seen as relating to one's inner spiritual condition rather than external actions. Woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites! For you clean the outside of the cup and of the dish, but inside they are full of greed and self-indulgence. You blind Pharisee, first clean the inside of the cup and of the dish, so that the outside of it may become clean also. Matthew 23:25-26. One's outward actions are then seen as the result of one's inner state. Once again, without emerges from within. Above all else, guard your heart, for everything you do flows from it. Proverbs 4:23. And again, the good man out of the good treasure of his heart brings forth what is good, and the evil man out of the evil treasure brings forth what is evil. For his mouth speaks from that which fills his heart. Luke 6:45. Once this is realized, the flaw with a solely consequentialist view of ethics becomes apparent. As was pointed out before, alignment with God's sense of goodness is good from a universally intersubjective and thus objective point of view. However, alignment with God occurs in one's inner condition rather than with one's exterior actions and their consequences. Thus, God's conception of goodness has more to do with one's inner condition than external factors. For a man looks at the outward appearance, but the Lord looks at the heart. 1 Samuel 16:7. In turn, this explains why lust and hatred are seen as bad as adultery and murder, respectively. The inner condition associated with the external actions is the same. You have heard that it was said, "You shall not commit adultery," but I tell you that anyone who looks at a woman lustfully has already committed adultery with her in his heart. Matthew 5:27-28. Everyone who hates his brother is a murderer. 1 John 3:15. Expanding on this concept, early Christianity developed this principle into the 7 deadly sins: luxuria or lust, gula or gluttony, avaratia or avarice, asceria or sloth, ira or wrath, invidia or envy, and superbia or pride. Rather than being a set of actions with consequences, each sin is an inner attitude or orientation of the heart. But what are the origins of these vices? If God's values are objectively good, then any intentionalities to create based on those values must also be objectively good. As such, all of creation must be good as well. Thus, the only way for a creation to be evil is through it being deprived of what is needed to make it good. This concept of evil as the absence of good is what is known as privatio boni. However, parts cannot simply vanish from existence and go missing from the whole. Thus, the privation must be one of a separation or break in the design of a good creation. Take a glass, for instance. By itself, it is good. but if it shatters on the floor, the glass shards it forms could cut a person's feet. Likewise, an inner vice could be analogized to a shattering or distortion in the ordering or syntax of one's inner conscious state. Thus, each vice would have its undistorted counterpart or virtue. This is seen in the seven cardinal virtues. The counterpart of lust, for instance, would be chastity. Undistorted gluttony would be temperance. Greed, charity, sloth, diligence, wrath, patience, envy, kindness, and pride, humility. To demonstrate, wrath would be a deficit of patience. Once this deficit is reordered so as to be completed, it would become patience. Once all of this is understood, the cause of the deficiencies seen in atheistic morality becomes apparent. A faulty materialistic metaphysics where the visible physical world is seen as mind-independent, and thus existing independent of God's mind, leads to a faulty view of meta-ethics and ethics. The secular approach to ethics factors out the universal intersubjectivity needed for objective morality, by factoring out the existence of the mind needed to have that frame of reference. The consequence is a view of ethics which is concerned only with the consequences in the external visible world, and not with one's inner state. However, once one remembers that the manifest physical world is necessarily being generated by an unmanifest mind, one's view of reality shifts, and one's connection to that mind through one's inner condition begins to factor in. As a consequence, the source of the flaw in secular approaches to ethics becomes apparent, as the framework in which they were invented is shown to be obsolete. Thus, by attacking a material view of the world, the undesirable rise of moral nihilism and crass hedonism can be countered, and eventually reversed to the more sensible views of morality once held.
Question is, are people free to reject this? Right? Now, to reject an idealistic framework, they can try, but this involves a couple things. To reject an idealistic metaphysical framework, one must accept at least one of two things. Accept dualism. Most people who accept dualism are religious, and you know, they're going to accept the Bible on this anyway. Or they reject dualism, but they argue that the mind and rationality are a product of unthinking matter. However, if you have unthinking matter giving rise to rationality, you can't really trust your rationality because, well, it's really just irrational chemicals bouncing around in your brain. So given that most secularists reject dualism, if they reject the framework, they can be automatically dismissed as irrational. And furthermore, the case for idealism from physics is quite solid if you saw some of my other talks, and so they have to reject science as well to get out of this. And then as for morality is concerned, in turn, objective morality outside of universal intersubjectivity is incoherent, right? Otherwise, it's just different relative value frames all arguing with each other. So thus, any moral system that does not include alignment with a universally intersubjective value frame, i.e. God's value frame, can be identified as incoherent. So if they reject this, they can be identified as irrational and incoherent when it comes to ethics. So, and then of course, some people will argue for nihilism and try and base it on pragmatism after that. The trouble with that is well, if pragmatism is, or nihilism is correct, and they just go on practical concerns, then I can say, well, I can find some way to become a president and shut down the Constitution and the democracy and use that to enforce my morality on everybody else. And since there's nothing wrong with that because morality is relative, I'm perfectly justified in doing that because now I'm beyond good and evil if nihilism is true. So they can't really get out that way either. So conclusions from this. The inner condition is more important than external consequences. And God's frame of reference is needed to ground meta-ethics since it's universally intersubjective, right? God's mind contains all their minds and thus all their frames of reference. And a wrong heart condition, you know, your motivation is due to privation in the form of a distortion or break in the intended design, forming ego or separation from God. So God makes a good puzzle and the puzzle breaks and now there's a piece of patience which is broken in half and now there's wrath there, which needs to be fixed with the other broken piece added back into it. And so this is all going on in your inner state. Thus, the reordering of one's inner state according to God's intended design is the chief concern of an idealistic ethics. So how the pieces fit together is, you know, what's supposed to be in terms of your inner state. It more involves, you know, you feel it differently in terms of, you know, conflicts between those vices and virtues, but really, it's about, you know, one way to frame it is the pieces putting together properly. So, now that we mentioned the pieces putting together properly, this raises an interesting question. You've heard the phrase, the parts don't fit. And so there's a reason for that. There's a parallel here. A good analogy so for this would be a broken puzzle where the pieces have not been properly ordered, like I just explained, and then it's pieces of consciousness. And now the thing is this applies within the individual. You know, you have vices and virtues that God, or vices that God wants to work with to restore. However, this also applies between relations between individuals, right? You know, you have a God's intended design for a community or a family or so on. How you put the puzzle together that way. So the question is there a similar gender pattern in the pleroma for male and female pieces of consciousness to integrate? You have them integrating in terms of the inner state, but now it's the inner state is actually a shared inner state, and God's running it, and he's simulating the whole world from it. And so is there a larger pattern than just our inner state mentally? And so this brings us to the next video. Turns out that there is.
Historically, society's concepts of gender have been largely shaped by their religions. For the past few millennia in the West, this has been in the form of Christianity. However, this same pattern is ubiquitous to human civilization. Notions such as gender complementarity and a spiritual dimension to gender, sexuality, and human relations can be found around the world and across human history. These are seen to form an integral part of the social institutions and norms of the cultures in which they are found. However, in the last half century, this trend has begun to be supplanted by a new trend largely unique to Western civilization. With the advent of the sciences, it was believed that everything had a material explanation, which naturally included biological sex. The account of the material sciences is that sexual dimorphism is the product of natural selection, which in turn is driven by genetics, which in turn is driven by the material interactions of unconscious molecules. Given that this material account of gender is devoid of any intentionality or purpose, it has led to a nihilistic view of gender, sexuality, and human relations. These ideas first manifested socially in the form of the radicalism and extremism of the 1960s. Since then, atheists and nihilists, lacking any transcendent reference point, have taken them in the direction of anime and social destructionism.
I agree. It's a no-brainer that we should have the right to marry. But I also think equally that it's a no-brainer that the institution of marriage should not exist. So that causes my brain some trouble. And part of it, why it causes me trouble, is because fighting for gay marriage generally involves lying about what we're going to do with marriage when we get there. You know, because we lie that the institution of marriage is not going to change. And that is a lie. The institution of marriage is going to change, and it should change. I don't think it should exist.
As this disintegration has progressed, it has led to extreme illiberalism, antisocial attitudes, and even blatant psychopathic behavior. Thus, to correct the social cataclysm in the making, it may be necessary to re-examine the foundations of these ideas to see where they went wrong. But this is easier said than done. At first glance, the material account seems complete. But appearances can be deceiving. Material accounts are good at explaining biology, but not psychology or phenomenology. At best, they can account for material correlates, but not phenomenology itself, as seen in the famed hard problem of consciousness. In reference to gender, this distinction is recognized by gender theory in the distinction it makes between sex and gender. Sex is seen as biological, whereas gender is seen as mental or psychological. Given that human beings are first and foremost minds, the origins of gender as a mental phenomenon rather than a biological one need to be accounted for the material explanation to be valid. However, for the reason given before, this is impossible.
And they begin to tell us at these gatherings, they said, in your lifetime, you're going to see things happen. It was strange when they said it in the 1950s and 1960s, but now it seems very clear, but then it was unusual. They said, you're going to see a time in your life, men are going to become women. They said, the Great Spirit, he's going to make a man on the earth. He made him a man, but this man's going to say, I know more than the Great Spirit. I'm going to change myself to be a woman. And they will even nurse children. They said, the Great Spirit's going to make a woman on this earth. She's going to say, I know more than the Great Spirit. I want to be a man. And she will be physically a man. This sounded strange.
To account for gender as a mental phenomenon, one needs to find its origins, and to do that, one needs a broader metaphysics than naive materialism. Given the incoherence of dualism due to the interaction problem, and that our fundamental physics is giving way to an idealistic picture of the world, the logical starting point is idealism. So the questions then arise, how do individuated minds come to be? And how does gender arise as a property of those minds? When we answer these questions from an idealist philosophy, we find interestingly that they recover the Christian teaching on the subject. On idealism, if we start at the beginning, we have just God's mind and its contents. However, given that this is a single conscious system, there is no individuation. To create an individual mind from the contents in God's mind, some of the consciousness needs to be stamped out, much like how a cookie is cut out of dough. Once this is done, the outline of the cookie perfectly complements the outline of the dough it was stamped out of. This produces an individual mind distinct from God, but also produces our first example of units of consciousness displaying complementary aspects. Each unit of consciousness needs the other to complete it and become one. Furthermore, the mind would only be created if God desired or valued it. In other words, God would love the individual person he creates. Thus, two aspects associated with gender emerge. The two genders complement each other, but are also held together in a love relationship. Here we find the first parallel to Christian teaching. He, referring to Christ, is before all things, and in him all things consist. And he is the head of the body, the church. Colossians 1:17-18. Christ is seen here as containing all things within his mind, including the church. However, Christ and the church are also repeatedly described as husband and bride. Thus a pattern emerges of female being cut out of male. Curiously, the same archetype shows up in the Genesis story of Eve being cut out of Adam. In turn, this reveals another pattern associated with gender. God being the creator first loves us, which is why we are created. Without being valued, there would be no intentionality to create. Thus Christ, which is associated with the husband, is seen as initiating the relationship, while the church, which is associated with the bride, is seen as being receptive towards it. Interestingly, this description of the masculine as initiating and the feminine as receptive is mirrored in actual psychological studies. In 2011, a poll of college students showed that 93% of women surveyed wanted to be asked out by men, whereas 83% of men wanted to ask out women. In regards to the complementary nature of gender, the cookie cutter analogy also replicates the Christian doctrine concerning marriage. In fact, the archetype in Genesis describes the reason for marriage as being precisely along these lines. The man said, "This is now bone of my bones, and flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman, because she was taken out of man. For this reason, a man shall leave his father and his mother, and be joined to his wife, and they shall become one flesh." Genesis 2:23-24. If individuation occurs by one becoming two, then the reason for marriage is the opposite. Rather than being an arbitrary human construct, this is due to the joint origin of said souls. The two complementary souls merge back into one as they move closer to their source in God. Thus every male would have his female counterpart, and every female her male counterpart. However, this individuation of gendered minds is not contained to psychology alone. Material explanations of the world are limited to reductionist accounts, and thus prefer a bottom-up explanation of the world. On an idealist paradigm, however, God contains everything, and yet is a single, undivided being. Thus, the individuation of smaller parts only occurs as a result of the whole creating the parts in a top-down fashion, rather than the parts creating the whole. Since all of creation would be mental, any individuated structure in existence must be treated as something along the lines of a program, rather than a material object. Thus, the pattern becomes generalized into a principle for everything in existence, rather than only conscious agents. Gendered units would thus form a fractal structure comprising everything in existence. Rather than being a random accident of nature, each cookie-cutter outline would have its twin silhouette to complement it, forming something of an Escher-like tapestry. Protons and electrons, for instance, share complementary charges and attract each other. The source of charge, in turn, is the zero-point field. A positive charge would necessarily leave a negatively charged hole, and the both would comprise a Dirac pair. DNA molecules are comprised of twin chains of base pairs, each complementing the other, and both needing to chemically bond to each other in order to replicate. This could also, in principle, be extended to complementary sexes in biology. If both reality and gender are mental, sex could never be fully dissociated from gender, as gender theory suggests. Rather than being distinct from gender, biological sex would have a gender as well, being a mind program simulated on consciousness rather than a material object. When applied to human social conventions, this accounts for the basis of traditional marriage. Man and woman would form complementary halves, not just psychologically, but biologically as well, and thus would need to unite along the same lines. In turn, marriage forms the foundation for the separate but related topic of Christian sexual morality. To replicate the Christian teachings on sexual morality in their entirety, the concepts in this video will need to be combined with those in privatio boni and a priori derivation, and through a mirror darkly. However, this will be the subject for a future video.
All right. So a quick comment with this video. I just wanted to address this because this came up when I made the video the first time. At 7-Eleven, say the two complementary souls merge back into one as they move closer to their source and God. And I specifically worded it this way so people would not confuse it. And despite that, some people confused it anyway. And so just for clarification, this means as a consequence of moving closer to God, not finding a soulmate will move you closer to God. Right. So you move close to God and you get all the desires of your heart, supposedly. So it's not the other way around. So now the gender pattern formula, male and female are cut out and cut out respectively. Eve is cut out of Adam, that's Genesis 23:24. Church cut out of Christ, Colossians 1:17-18. And this pattern is necessary as a necessary consequence of the process of individuation, right? This is not just theology, this is idealist philosophy. You have to have, you know, if there's going to be something created, it has to be created or punched out of something like a cookie cut out of dough. And so a gender complementarity falls out necessarily as well. Complementarity meaning separate, equal, and synergistic. So it's the cookie and the dough, they match each other. They're cut out of each other, and so therefore they automatically match each other. And so this pattern is needed for the consciousness units to be put together the right way. Anything out of that, they're in a state of ego, which is, here. Remember the original state, God created everything good, because of the previous video, and so therefore privation is therefore automatically when the pieces are out of alignment, and so the pieces arranged in a complementary fashion is the way they were cut out, the way they were created, and so that is the right way, and anything outside of that is necessarily in a state of ego, and so necessarily false or bad. Gives you back the marriage is a 1+1=1 formula. Marriage is the pattern of ego dissolution between two complementary genders. Two separate ego fragments die, as it were, and are thus reborn. And this kind of puts a new spin on till death do us part. Basically, it's two people dying for each other rather than just staying with each other till they die. So husbands ought to also love their own wives as their own bodies. He who loves his own wife loves himself. That's Ephesians 5:28. That's kind of signifying that they're one single unit rather than, you know, the cookie and dough put together. And then for this reason, a man shall leave his father and his mother and be joined to his wife, and they shall become one flesh. Remember, the previous verse to that was Eve being cut out of Adam because it was the rib, right? And so the two pieces come back together. So now I had a complaint from some atheists saying that I just concocted this and this is not, you know, I just made this up, this does not reflect reality. And to disprove that, I'm going to show you that in my research on this pattern actually shows up in comparative religion as well. And this doesn't mean these religions are all true, but it does mean that this was a universally understood thing back in the day. And this is not just me saying this or just Christianity saying this. This kind of transcends religion. So I'll give you a couple of examples. Ancient Egyptian religion, you have Isis and Osiris. They're brother and sister, and that doesn't mean this was an incestuous relationship. What they're trying to signify in Egyptian cosmogony was that these were twin souls with a joint origin, and in turn, their husband and wife, the two pieces, joint origin, and then they merge back together as husband and wife. Hinduism, we have the same thing with Shiva and Shakti. Shiva represents the male archetype. Shakti represents the female archetype. And they were originally in this state of samadhi, and the two separated, and the two merged back into a state called samadhi, wherein both are dissolved back into an original state of unity. So this is two becoming one again. Then we have ancient Sumerian cosmogony. There's creation originated from a sacred mountain called Anki. This was later separated into An, which is heaven, and Ki, which is earth. An was seen as masculine and Ki as feminine. So it's two parts split, and after it splits, now you have the origin of male and female. Neoplatonist influenced philosophies. One example would be the principle of mental gender, and this one's kind of interesting because it kind of parallels what we just went over. There's two aspects of the psyche in this principle, the I, or identity, and the me, which is the contents of the mind that defines what the mind identifies as, like your, you know, your values and beliefs and memories and so on. And the I is masculine, and the me is feminine, and the I contains the me. So it's, you know, Eve contained in Adam, or the church contained in Christ, basically, in those verses you saw in the video. Sufi Islam. Out of the original unity of being, there is a fragmentation and dispersal of beings. That sounds like the video we just touched. And the last stage being the splitting of one soul into two, and consequently love is the search by each half for the other half on earth or in heaven. And that's Sufi saying from Sufi Islam. So it's the soul here would, you know, not just be your, it's your mental, you know, what's in your mind, but it's also your soul generating your body as well. All right, so sexual misbehavior and deviancy, as I explained earlier, the gendered units are designed to fit into the marriage pattern. Anything outside of this, activities that do not fit into the pattern are in a state of ego, or that's the breaking of the original good state, in a state of privation. Ego is a state of misalignment with God, and thus with universal intersubjectivity, sorry, a mouthful, and is thus objectively wrong. And of course, you don't need religion to argue that. You can argue that from idealist philosophy instead. And thus, the gender pattern can be used to identify and study sexual misconduct and various deviancies. And we're going to do that now. So the first is the generic thing. This is lust. This is not any specific one. This is a category of them, you know, the inner state that's off. The deadly sin at the root of sexual sins, lust involves a selfish desire to break the pattern giving one's sexuality to one's spouse. That's the design pattern. Lust is equivalent to adultery. That's Matthew 5:27-28. And the question is, does this have an effect? According to Psychology Today, half of all divorces are due to pornography consumption. And approximately 500,000 marriages a year end due to one of the partners being involved with porn. And so this is actually borne out in reality that this breaks the marriage pattern, the gender pattern, that you would expect if it's, that's what privation is. And this brings us to divorce. Let no one deal treacherously against the wife of your youth, for I hate divorce, says the Lord, Malachi 2:15-16, and then another verse in that. This one is kind of very explicit on the pattern. You see the gender pattern here reflected. So they are no longer two, but one flesh. Two pieces are merged back. Therefore, what God has joined together, let no one separate. And so that's the reason why divorce is bad. God brought them two together, two separate egos together, and merged them together in God. And so the marriage is getting rid of ego between a couple and between the couple and God. Thus, divorce automatically creates ego. It breaks the gender pattern back apart and therefore creates ego. And ego is, of course, a state of privation, which is wrong on idealist ethics. Premarital sex. Here's another one. Myriad verses on this. I'll go through them all, but there's no incomplete spiritual integration of the pieces in the pattern. So you're fitting the sexual part of the pattern together, putting the puzzle pieces together in such a way that they don't fully merge together. You're just uniting, the couple is united in body but not in spirit, and so premarital sex ignores the spiritual dimension of sex, which is the two egos merging together as one and creates ego in the process, because it's not the gender pattern that was stamped out. Then polygamy and polyamory. For this reason, a man shall leave his father and mother and be joined to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh, the two, so not three or four. Then they are no longer two, but one flesh. So two become one, not multiple become one, right? It's a cutout and cutoutee. It's not multiple cutouts. So looking at the gender pattern as a cutout pattern, this makes sense. The human sex ratio is approximately 1:1. If you have a puzzle that has, you know, half fishes and half horses, like the Escher painting there, you're going to have an equal, it's going to be one fish to one horse rather than, you know, one horse to two fishes or so on. And so simply by nature of the fact that it's a 1:1 ratio, you can see that that's how the pattern was designed to be put back together. So the gender pieces don't fit in a polyamorous fashion. Anything not in the pattern is in a state of ego, which again is wrong. The pattern even shows up in nature with Fisher's principle, this is in biology, which causes the one-to-one sex ratio to be nearly universal in all species, and there's one exception of paper wasps. But maybe God just decided to cut out more pieces, as it were, simulate more female wasps than male wasps or something. Now, of course, a lot of criticism, this is a common criticism that's seen, is atheists will say, well, there was polygamy in the Bible, and so therefore any our attempts to defend marriage and so on are, we have no high ground to stand on because the Bible has polygamy in it as well. You have examples, the patriarchs, Jacob had Leah and Rachel, Abraham had Sarah and Hagar. But if you think about this, the Bible didn't actually condone this, it just recorded them. And if you look at it, the Bible doesn't actually portray this as good. Both of these resulted in family feuds, right? The one family split, and Leah and Rachel were always fighting. So a Jewish scholar, Robert Alter's The Art of Biblical Narrative, points out that there was polygamy, but it wasn't portrayed as good in the Bible. God simply tolerated it at the time. He didn't condone it or anything like that. All right, so now the next one is homosexuality and transsexuality, and we're covering this because we see this a lot in the media today. It's kind of what motivated the attack on marriage. Homosexuality is the first effect mentioned in the Romans 1 passage as a result of forgetting about God. The question is, why is this, right? I mean, there are some homosexuals who believe in God and so on, so what's this getting at? To examine homosexuality, it may be helpful to first look at the more extreme case of transsexuality or gender identity disorder. So, what is being ignored is that the material bodies in the unmanifest world, or the manifest physical world, are being generated by the unmanifest mind. And this is what it was meant by forgetting God. You know, a lot of times people will think that, well, there's God over there, and then there's this material world here, and this has no bearing on connecting to God. And so what they're forgetting is not that there is a God, but what God is in relation to the world in a very real sense. They're forgetting this whole mental dimension to reality, basically. And so the gender pattern applies to everything that is individuated, not just human minds, and that includes human bodies. If you have a body or some object that's being simulated on consciousness and idealism rather than just being sitting there, right? So everything is automatically individuated as a cutout. But since on idealism, which is consciousness, in this case God's consciousness, generates reality, physical morphology, which is the shape of one's body, is caused by intentionality. If there's a thought pattern, that thought pattern is going to manifest as a specific morphology or geometry in physical reality. So you can see the intent of a body by the shape of the body, basically. So there is a gendered unit of consciousness generating a male body, be a male unit of consciousness, a cutout E, and another gendered unit of consciousness generating a female body, or a cutout. And so what's really going on is you have to merge not just the minds, but the bodies as well, because you're not realizing that the bodies are also part of the pattern. And so look at the trans case of this. This is the more extreme one. It's more illustrative this way. In the trans case, there is the distortion between the gender of the individual mind and the gender of the consciousness generating the body. Whereas in the cis case, consciousness is correctly aligned. So you see there's a male consciousness pattern and a female consciousness pattern. And then within that, they're basically generating avatars, and the players, as it were, in the avatars are misaligned from the bodies they're in. And so this, of course, creates a state of ego or separation between the individual and the mind generating the bodies, the program generating the bodies. And so homosexuality is the same thing, except instead of it being the whole gender flipping, it's just the sexual orientation being misaligned. And so that explains what's wrong with transsexuality and homosexuality, respectively. All right. In turn, this could actually explain things like the AIDS epidemic. It's a very high, I think I saw the stats in this sometime back, but I forget what they were exactly. But there's a high prevalence of AIDS among the homosexual community. And, well, the problem is homosexuality lacks gender complementarity. You know, this is not to say that you won't find some homosexual couples that are true to each other, but by and large, they're not actually going to fit together psychologically or anything. And so this could naturally lead to a constant search for partners. They can't get what they need in one partner, so they go to the next one and the next one. And this actually shows up in the evidence. Bell and Weinberg reported evidence of widespread sexual compulsion among homosexual men. 83% of homosexual men surveyed estimated they had sex with 50 or more partners in their lifetime. 43% estimated they had sex with 500 or more partners, and 28% with 1,000 or more partners. So there's no, in a large case of this, there's no indication of, you know, real marriage in the sense of two becoming one. They have to keep going for a partner after a partner to try and find someone who complements them, but they can't find someone who complements them because their consciousness is such that they can't do that. So, and of course, high promiscuity then leads to high STD transmission, which explains why the AIDS epidemic is so high among the homosexual community and not the straight community. So now, the next thing we're going to get to is homosexuality is an abomination, and this is, of course, controversial by some, so we're just going to kind of look at this and parse it apart and see the reasons why. If a man lies with a woman as a male, if a man lies with a male as he lies with a woman, both of them have committed an abomination, Leviticus 20:13. And of course, you shall not lie with a male as with a woman, it is an abomination, Leviticus 18:22. And so the question, of course, is why is this seen as controversial? This is often kind of brought up as a thing, so I figured I'd address it. Firstly, there's the fallacy of equivocation, equivocating between homosexual behavior and homosexuality as a condition. You know, people are not abominations, behavior is, and so people often equivocate between the two, especially among the politically correct crowd, and they can't tell the two are actually different. And so, because of that, they automatically assume you're saying something you're not. Second is an emotional reaction. It seems kind of more harsh language, as it were, and so people react to it, but that's not really a logical argument. And then the last reason is really just ignorance. This is the big one. They just don't know why it's this way, and when we see why, it makes perfect sense. So first we have to look at what was meant by abomination in Leviticus. The word used for abomination is toiva in Hebrew, and has a connotation of being unholy or anti-holy, or being contrary to natural order. Of course, holiness is aligned with God's will, and the gender pattern is the product of God's intentionality. So it basically means anti-alignment. So thus, anti-alignment with the gender pattern would be defined as unholy, a.k.a. toiva, or a.k.a. abomination. So it really is just, it's not really, I mean, you might say it's harsh language, but it's not meant to be harsh. It's just saying this is what it is in a very literal kind of, you know, transitive, logical sort of way. So note that transsexuality, which is anti-aligned as well with the same gender pattern, is also called toiva in Deuteronomy 22:5. So when you understand that, well, of course, it's just saying that it's anti-aligned from its telos, and so therefore they identify anti-alignment with telos with abomination. And so when you understand that, this is a perfectly reasonable conclusion to say that homosexuality and transsexuality are abominations because they're anti-aligned with which is what the word abomination means. So it's only seen as controversial due to a lack of understanding about the gender pattern. So people who do that simply don't know what they're talking about, which is kind of unfortunate, but, you know, politely correct them and explain it to them. Okay, so now we're going to go to the next problem. The previous things are, you know, sexual sins, and people do those, and, you know, it's not good, but these are things that people fall for. The next problem is a little bit, it bugs me more, actually. Call it the phenomenon of the little boy who cried homophobe. And this one is where you have people trying to defend this in a very hateful fashion. For example, you'll see extremists who label everything they disagree with as bigoted, homophobic, or nondescript hate. And obviously that's ridiculous because you could just call any disagreement, no matter what, bigoted or homophobic, and that really is a nondescript term, which, you know, if you use it for everything, it doesn't mean anything anymore. And so obviously this is really just an indication of people having a temper tantrum because someone happened to disagree with them. So obviously, you can't take these people seriously, this kind of extremist behavior, but it does merit investigation as to why the behavior is so extreme and irrational like this. And so the question is, what accounts for this behavior? Why is this so visceral a reaction among people? And one of the reasons is, a lot of the reason is people kind of bought into this, they didn't, you know, realize why they just kind of adopted the LGBT propaganda, gay propaganda, And here's an example of a pair of sexual subversives, Marshall Kirk and Hunter Madsen in After the Ball. And they say, this is from their book, note that the bigot need not actually be made to believe that he is such a heinous creature that others will now despise him, and that he has been the immoral agent of suffering. It would be impossible to make him believe any such thing. Rather, our effect is achieved without reference to facts, logic, or proof. And so what they're doing here is admitting that they're actually engaging in deceptive propaganda to dissuade people and rile them up into a mob mentality, which kind of makes sense when you see the reaction. Next question is, has this worked? Does this propaganda, does this strategy work? And the answer is actually yes. A Gallup survey from this year demonstrates that a majority of Americans hold scientifically incorrect beliefs due to homosexual propaganda. They had a belief, for example, that is, you know, is same-sex orientation innate or environmental? And as you can see, in the last couple of years, it went from, you know, 30, about even to 51% believe it's innate, other 30% believe it's not. And this actually demonstrates that the 51% are actually false. This was actually scientifically falsified in 2014 by 8 separate studies of identical twins conducted by in Australia, the U.S., and the U.S. and Scandinavia, but I didn't put that there, that showed people are not born with gay genetics. Some of these surveys, studies were actually done before this, but I think they were compiled more recently than that. So, oh, wait a minute, this is the wrong, this was not included here. Let's get the studies up. I was going to look into the studies for a minute. Yeah, here we go. Yeah, I think I put the wrong one in.
Well, that's the results, but go to the slide just before it.
This one. Okay, yeah. So studies, identical twins have the same genetics, as you know. Oh, expand it into the same birth environment. So if homosexuality is genetic or determined in utero, then both twins should be homosexual. But this was discovered not to be the case. The methodology for this was homosexuality was cross-referenced using twin registers. Some of them are quite large. The Australian twin register, for instance, has 25,000 people. And so they simply went on the twin register and saw, you know, here's an identical twin who's homosexual. Is his other twin gay as well? And what they discovered was that this was actually, in fact, not the case. And this one is from Bierman and Bruckner, 2002. Opposite sex twins in adolescent same-sex attraction. Sample size was 4,901 twins. In a U.S. study, the same-sex attraction concordance between identical twins was only 7.7 for males and 5.3 for females. They found also that from 16 to 17 years old, if a person had a romantic attraction for to the same sex, almost all had switched 1 year later. And a similar study from Australia, concordance rate of 11% for males and 14% for females. That's Bailey M. et al., 2000, in genetic and environmental influences on sexual orientation and its correlates in an Australian in Australian twin samples. That was from Psychological Journal. So as you can see, this is actually, the conclusions from this are homosexuality is not primarily genetic or innate, as opposed to contrary belief. Since twins have nearly identical DNA, the concordance for the rate for homosexuality should be close to 100%, but it isn't. It's actually very small. There's almost no genetic correlation at all. And the second one is, well, is homosexuality mutable? This one is, you know, another myth that's commonly proposed, and this was also experimentally falsified. Neutral academic surveys show that there is a substantial change. About half of the homosexual bisexual population in a non-therapeutic environment moves towards, that's without, you know, therapy to change orientation, moves towards heterosexuality over a lifetime. About 3% of the present heterosexual population once firmly believed themselves to be homosexual or bisexual. And the interesting thing is the study this comes from, this is Bierman and Bruckner, they were pro-gay. They weren't trying to set up with an agenda to prove this, they just noticed this. And they also know that the only stability was among those who stayed heterosexual. So this indicates this is more of a psychological problem or socially conditioned condition that changes rather than something that's a genetic orientation in itself. And so, of course, well, the problem with this is, you know, the scientific evidence has confirmed that the LGBT civil rights movement is based on a fraud. you know, civil rights issues are for minority groups that are that way by identity of what they are, but the problem is, as shown by the studies, unlike race, homosexuality is not genetically inborn, unlike with an authentic minority group. You know, like if you're black, you were born with black genetics. If you're female, you were born with female genetics, but this is not genetics. This is, you know, you can't, if someone can change identities, you know, they saw that the half the people from 16 to 17 changed identities, then obviously it can't be an identity because, well, the person's two identities now, which would be like saying that someone's both black and white or male and female at the same time. So meaning, then, if that's false, if they're not really an authentic minority group, this means that the basis for including it under the Civil Rights Act, which has begun to violate religious and conscience rights, is also based on a fraud. And this is a very serious thing. You have cases like Joe and Melissa Klein from Oregon, who have just been fined $135,000 by some scary judges. You know, the basis on this, the Civil Rights Act, and the premise on which this was included is scientifically fraudulent and has been shown to be through experiment now. So gay propaganda is fraudulent, but it works, and this may explain why Russia and Eastern European countries take it so seriously. They don't want, you know, religious and conscience rights violations to affect their citizens, and also probably defend the children against propaganda as well. All right, so let's go back to the main one. Oh, wait. Where's the... Okay. Here we go. Now, this isn't the only reason behind this, by the way. Obviously, some of it's gay propaganda. Uh-oh, I think you got it wrong.
That's okay.
The second reason... Okay, so the question is, what about the people pushing the propaganda? What's up with the sexual extremism of, like, say, left-wing radicalism, social justice warriors, etc.? Now, notice that, this is an important clue here, notice that many of these same people do not have much sexual morality elsewhere. For example, you have radical extremists like Dan Savage who promote things like promiscuity and pornography to teenagers. He's actually on Big Think giving an argument for why polygamy was good. And you can see that they're obviously morally flawed elsewhere sexually, and so this is, you know, usually someone will not be, you know, morally degenerate across the board like this, but this is kind of an interesting clue. And then also, when you look at, say, social justice warriors, and you see things like many also display psychological characteristics that are common with sociopaths. For example, pathological lying, which is just the subversive propaganda you saw before, poor impulse control, which just explains why they to attack people, promiscuity, which we saw that before, lack of remorse and sympathy. You see this with social justice warriors who attack a person and then, you know, they have no sympathy for what they did. In fact, they're happy about it afterward. Irresponsibility, domineering, et cetera, et cetera. And I didn't mention this in the PowerPoint, but there's actually a psychologist from University of Vancouver who noticed that social justice warriors, he's John Ray, and he had a thing on subclinical psychopathy, and he noticed that social justice warriors actually display many of the traits of psychopaths, but to a subclinical degree. They're like level of psychopathy that is not quite full-blown psychopathy, but it's a form of psychopathy. So the question is, what is behind this pattern? Why do they behave like this? And because this seems to be a larger phenomenon than just reacting to the stuff they don't like. So, well, I think about from the gender pattern, you know, think about from the idealist philosophy, you have the gender pattern exists at the spiritual layer of reality, and so they have an inability to sense that sexual misconduct is wrong. You know, most of the time, or it's actually a symptom of a larger, and this is actually a symptom of a larger problem. So, you know, when you have kids, they'll say that, say, you know, teenagers or something, they might think that they have a kind of innate sense of something like, say, you know, polyamory is twisted or something, you know, you shouldn't be cheating on your significant other, or, you know, that maybe homosexuality is gross, or so on. And this is kind of a common trait seen throughout the population, unless they have been, you know, subjected to subversive propaganda. And but you notice these people can't sense this, actually. And so the question is, why is this? And so we see a parallel here. I'm going to explain, this is the verse, I'm going to explain this in terms of idealist philosophy in a moment. And even though they did not like to retain God in their knowledge, God gave them over to a debased mind, to things, those things which are not fitting, being filled with all unrighteousness, sexual immorality, wickedness, covetousness, maliciousness, full of envy, murder, strife, deceit, evil-mindedness. They are whisperers, backbiters, haters of God, violent, proud, boasters, inventors of evil things, disobedient to parents, undiscerning, untrustworthy, unloving, unforgiving, unmerciful. Well, that sounds kind of like the list of those psychopathic character traits we discussed before. And so we think about this. This is, you know, if they can't sense the gender pattern, they have a lack of spiritual sensation, as it were. That's because they've been so disordered out of the gender pattern that they actually can't sense what's going on there anymore. And so they literally cannot sense that any of these things are wrong. And so this is due to severe ego consciousness, to the point of not having any spiritual connection at all, manifesting as a pathology. So, let's see here. Now, question is there any evidence of this? Actually, there is. What evidence is there this is cause? According to National Review, churches declined in attendance shortly after liberalizing their sexual morality. The United Church of Christ declined by 20.4% in the first 7 years after recognizing same-sex marriage. And the Presbyterian Church of the USA liberalized its stance on sexuality in 2006 and lost 22.4% of its members by 2013. Meanwhile, socially conservative churches like Assemblies of God and the Mormon Church grew in attendance. And so the conclusion to draw from this is actually that this gender pattern is real, and you actually see this by the effect that, you know, being integrated into the gender pattern also means being integrated into God insofar as that's part of alignment with God, and therefore you have increased spirituality. And then when you break off from that with sexual liberalism, this statistically correlates to repressed spirituality. And so it's evidence that the people are actually broken off completely from the gender pattern. They can't even sense it. And so it explains the data on that. And so the last thing, and this is another reason people get angry, and this actually is a valid reason. This is a word of caution to Christians who talk to people. This is a line from The Devil's Advocate, the movie Devil's Advocate, where Al Pacino is playing the devil. He says, "Let me give you a little inside information about God. God likes to watch. He's a prankster. Think about it. He gives man instincts. He gives you this extraordinary gift, and then what does he do? I swear, for his own amusement, his own private cosmic gag reel, he sets the rules in opposition. He's a sadist. He's an absentee landlord. Worship that? Never." So, you know, some people who are suffering with this, they can't, you know, they were conditioned like this somehow. They can't really help that they have these impulses. It's not fair that they were given these, and so it seems like God is then telling them they can't act on them and, you know, is depriving them of something good. So we have a sleight of hand here. This is why we should be very careful dealing with this. The appearance is often that God gave people desires, you know, homosexual desires, for example. God wants to take away good things based on those desires. That's the adversarial role. God wants to prevent you from having good things. And then when you break God's laws, God accuses people of wrongdoing for acting on these desires. That's the accusatory role. And so, of course, then God is also keeping people from being connected in a loving state, which, you know, God is love, supposedly, in the Bible. So if you're disconnected from that, you're disconnected from God, and that's the fallen state. And so this mirrors, in a way, the fallen state. And so you have this illusion where God is an accusing adversary who deprives people of good things, mirroring a fallen state. And, well, if that's God, then, yeah, God deserves to be hated, right? And, you know, I have a friend who came out to me about a year ago, and he's doing the right thing with it. He's not engaging in this stuff, and I said I thought he was a very noble person for doing that. But the thing is, you know, if he were to stumble a bit, the last thing you need is for someone to take a Bible and thump him over the head with it, right? That would give him the idea that God is a bully trying to harm him. So, and the reason that this is a God to be hated is because it quite literally is God. It's not God at all. It's the devil in a God costume. Now, this should be very careful when they accuse people of sinning and so on, based, you know, thumping people over the Bible. The Greek for accuser is diabolos. I misspelled it there by accident, but God is made to appear diabolical. So no wonder there is, you know, what, it's no surprise people are angry at God. They're actually angry at the devil, but they think they're angry at God because it appears God is the one doing all this. In reality, God doesn't blame people for their privations. You know, God forgave everyone at the cross, what they don't have. And then God wants to fulfill their desires after they're undistorted. You know, it's not like God wants to prevent someone. If that's the desires of their heart, to have a relationship, God's going to give them that to them eventually, but he has to undistort it first. He's not someone who gives them things and then takes stuff away from them and prevents them from having things. And so there's no, you know, in order to get there, though, you have to love God to be able to connect to God to be able to do that. And there's no way someone can love God or delight in the Lord if they see God as diabolical or a monster or something. So the lesson here is be careful how you approach this with LGBT members, because you might create a barrier between them and God. So this is the end of the talk. All right.
Just because one encounters a desire does not automatically mean that God gave it.
Well, he created all the desires initially, and then the desires became distorted. So it's not like let me put it like this. Homosexuality or premarital sex as a desire is a bad thing, but it was a piece of a good thing.
It's supposed to be fixed.
God didn't create anything bad, and so therefore everything created is good, and God said it's good. And
right.
So therefore, what we see as badness down here is broken goodness, basically. It's something God wants to fix, and then.
Yes, but what I'm trying to say is we as human beings have the capability of attaching ourselves to anything we pick, literally.
That is true.
So that being the case, just because we want to do something does not mean that God had anything to do with that.
Right. Well, in that case, I'd probably say I agree with you, basically, but these are the initial, you know, desires, right? The desires afterward of what you want to do based on that, and are desires generated by the broken state itself. And I'm not talking about those. I'm talking about the initial ones that God created to give people that then got broken afterward. So,
one thing that occurs to me is I'm listening to this is it looks like we haven't really gotten away from the idea that you can show this without God.
Right. The catch is that now we don't need, you know, religion or faith to prove God. We can demonstrate it through the science or the philosophy of mind. And so
that's something, of course, that will be hotly debated.
Oh, yeah. But as I pointed out, you can simply point out that people who do that are automatically irrational because, you know, they're saying that their irrationality is based on irrational material forces, and that they also reject science based on the evidence we showed. So we just have to press in the science and show them that.
That is true. I think that one of the points that we need to realize is that there's not a lot of point in arguing against homosexuality in particular,
but it's
and other ones in general, unless you're willing to go through the in other words, the forgetting God comes first, the homosexual comes afterwards,
right,
rather than vice versa.
Right.
Just a minute, we have
thank you for your talk. Sometimes I have a hard time following, but
I try to explain things.
I know. You're so smart about all these things. But I was very interested that you pointed out the studies showing that homosexuality is not genetic, because I've almost become convinced that sometimes it, I don't know about genetic, but that there might be some predisposition, because
right. Well, that's
even
the
young
thing.
Boys, I don't know how to explain, but I can see where it makes a lot of difference if we can establish clearly that it is not genetic, that there is a social or underlying, and you know, the
psychological,
the sin problem.
It's not that it's entirely, some of it may be out of the control, but it's psychological conditioning, which is an external influence.
I thought maybe, what do you think of this? I thought perhaps at, we know the race has degenerated over the millennium. And genetics could be, genetic patterns can be altered. They've shown that with apes, for instance. And I don't know if it's epigenetics or just what, but so that it could, there could be some influence that comes in if a pattern, if a practice is passed down and becomes more prevalent. And I know this homosexuality has been practiced for thousands of years.
That's Lamarckian. You know, there's the studies. The problem with that is they had this idea called Lamarckian evolution one time, where scientist Lamarck thought, you know, maybe it's an acquired characteristic that happened due to external conditions. So he said, let's chop off a rat's tail, and therefore the baby rats will then grow without tails. And he did this, and it doesn't work. It's just part of the genetics and epigenetics, and the baby rats all come out with tails every single time.
I'm going to reevaluate my thoughts on that.
I will mention, though, that I actually had believed, like you had, before
met
these studies. I had bought the propaganda too. I'm like, I figured I guess it must be innate, and you know, it kind of made sense because it didn't seem like you would choose these impulses. And
because young boys can feel as you know, the older people, they say, well, when I was I even had these feelings when I was, like 9 years old. I mean, where does that come from?
Just because you choose it, though, doesn't mean it's innate. It could be psychologically conditioned in some
way. That, I think, I like that. It makes things much more clear-cut, much more reasonable. Yeah, thank you.
Yep.
Question.
Yeah.
I noticed that one of the activists seemed to want to, am I wording it correctly? Somehow destroy marriage altogether.
Yeah.
Am I understanding this right?
Yeah, that's what they wanted. That's
okay, now the question that I'm puzzled about is, if marriage is the general, the majority of the sources of the next generation, where is the next generation of gays going to come from?
Well, they'll have premarital sex or extramarital sex, I'm supposing, and so. Oh, you mean the gay? I mean, you mean the population at large, or the?
Yes, yes. I mean, I.
Well, the population at large, actually, the marriage rate has dropped precipitously in the last 10 years or so, which is kind of crazy. It's kind of going into uncharted territory, and look, the whole thing is going to lead to a big social cataclysm.
Europe's population is collapsing now.
Europe's population is collapsing, and America's not. Is going in the same direction if it doesn't fix the pattern. Yeah, that's the thing. Remember this is something interesting. I mentioned that was gender was like a fractal pattern. And when you see, you know, you think of this as just, you know, individuals at a local scale, you know, either individual choices or go beyond that, just, you know, male and female. And it's actually men and women are not, or individuals are not dissociated from the society at large. And the society, when you break the pattern up, it actually disintegrates the whole society. The whole puzzle starts falling apart. And so you see now in Europe, they have places with below sustainable birth rates, like they're going into a demographic implosion. There's a limit, I think.
1.4 per couple or something like that.
Yeah, 1.4. And there's beyond something like that. I saw this by some demographers. I can't cite this because I don't remember where, but I saw that some demographers had a limit. They call it the death spiral. And after this limit, it'll automatically go, the society will actually collapse uncontrollably because they will not have the people needed to maintain the infrastructure, the next generation. And so after that, once it gets below a certain threshold, the whole thing collapses into it can't recover. It's like being sucked into a black hole. And so you see this in Europe and a lot of, they don't want to admit it, but they're an aging population. And
an interesting discussion this last week for me, in that the Supreme Court decision, and the argument back to me was that it was genetic and that these people are always this way. And my problem with that has been, it's hard for me to believe that God would hold people accountable for something they had absolutely no choice over,
right?
Type of an argument. So I appreciate the studies that would contradict that. And the other thing that's very important about those is, if they had a romantic encounter in basically junior high time period, that has a tremendous influence on who's going to be my kids' teachers during that confusing time period of their life. And since you can't procreate, you have to recruit. And so if you're advocating that strongly, that's going to have a profound influence on those children. But the discussion led right up into, since we're having this Adventist discussion regarding ordination, and it was interesting, the same argument person that argued that it's genetic and that it's perfectly fine and that we just need to be loving, and love caps everything, and we just need to be loving, which is absolutely true, that we need to be loving, but he was perfectly fine with ordaining a gay minister.
Right, well, the answer there would be loving, you show them compassion, but that doesn't mean you don't tell them the truth either. You don't Bible thump them and take the Bible and go bang, bang, bang.
I agree, but the issue is, where this is why we just studied this in relative to creation. Once you start to pick and choose which part of the scriptures you're going to eliminate, true, there's different interpretations, trying to put it in context, trying to make sure we understand the original language and the original context, and lots of study to be done on that. But once you start picking and choosing and saying, well, this part of scripture no longer applies, genetic has changed, this has happened, so this part of scripture no longer applies, but this part does, you end up with no basis for, they argued that a minister that was in an adulterous relationship shouldn't be ordained, but a homosexual one that was in a monogamous relationship should be. Well, how do you pick and choose which one of the things Paul said?
Well, here's the irony in that, is there's actually a pair, I think they're Baptist, but I'm not certain, this is the most outrageous thing, like outrageous, but also like laughably ridiculous. There was a pair of ministers and their wives who were actually openly swingers, and they were using this to try and evangelize something like this. And it was like a thing where they were, the two couples were swingers, and they would go with each other, and like, you got, they're both ordained ministers. I'm like, this is ridiculous. And yeah, so yeah, that sounds outrageous. What you just, you know, some like, you know,
but the problem is, if you take away any absolute authority, you now become the authority yourself.
Exactly. That's why I mentioned nihilism. I said the problem with nihilism is, if nihilism is true, then I can just become dictator and impose my will, and there's nothing wrong with me doing it because morality is out the window. I'm beyond good and evil now. And yeah, exactly. I agree.
Aren't we almost there?
He brought that up as a cartoon thing, you know, like a... Well, wouldn't it be outrageous if, you know, we had polygamous or adulterous pastors? And I actually mentioned, actually, that already exists.
Right, and you're the homophobe if you are saying anything, speak up your mind. But it looks like we're...
Well, they'll cry homophobe at the moon if you give them a chance. It's just people who cry temper, have a temper tantrum because someone didn't happen to agree with them, so...
It looks like we're reliving 1938 when Hitler was coming up and says, "War says no, it's okay."
Yeah,
says,
I don't know what the future holds. The future looks scary.
Yeah, but maybe we can lift our arms as our redemption right now.
Yep.
I mean, we're so close. We're so close.
Yep.
And it's going to happen so quickly.
Yeah. Well, that's we can't. I mean, we can argue this stuff, and I that's why I put this together because I realized we had no good arguments that were outside of, you know, that were not religious. So I figured we actually got to start to fix this problem. You need to bring back the religious component, but you can't do it on faith grounds anymore because that doesn't belong in a secular context, right? That which is what, you know, we have the separation of church and state thing. And so if we're going to bring this stuff back into the public square, we have to make secular arguments for it, and you need to do that by replicating, you know, the reasons for it, which are religious originally, and replicating the kind of the lost knowledge that was the basis for it, and showing how it actually fits into a rational framework now, which is what I was aiming to do here.
So. Well, there's one other way of approaching it, and that is to say, you know what, our faith does touch science. Mm-hmm. And rather than trying to separate the two desperately so that your faith can never be disproved by science, allow your faith to step into the scientific realm and start making predictions that might come out true.
Yeah.
For example, it's really interesting, and why weren't people who were of faith, the people who wanted to investigate whether twin studies actually bear out the idea that that homosexuality was inborn, because they could have discovered it earlier. Mm-hmm. The fact of the matter is that there, as I understand it, there are at least 8 studies now, two of them which I've looked at, and they're very clear that homosexuality is not concordance even among monozygotic twins who have
within a few base pairs, the exact same
genes, the exact same environment,
and the exact same intrauterine environment. So, you know, if it's the mother's hormones, no, it won't work that way.
It's all the exact now, same birth conditions.
Now, having said that, I think there's something else to be said too, and that is that if this came up from early, very early childhood, one would have no memories, even legitimate ones, of ever being different from what one was.
Right.
So that from an experiential point of view, it may feel inborn even though it isn't. And I don't think that we should accuse these people of lying when they say, well, I've always been that way. Well, ever since they can remember, they have always been that
right.
way.
Not so, them, but the propagandists. The right. individual people could be, that they might just be socially conditioned from
right.
early and so on.
The other point is that I think we need to be very careful about how we deal with this, and this is perhaps the most important point of all, and that is, let's take something that is very clearly environmental, cigarette smoking, and that pretty much everybody now agrees is not a good idea, mm-hmm. and therefore, in a certain sense, is wrong. Okay? There are people who have a terrible time quitting smoking. Some people who have experientially not been able to quit so far. And I say so far because maybe if we're lucky, we'll be able to reach it.
But does it make
maybe some people don't want to quit.
Right.
You know, in which case trying to get them to quit is it's a fool's errand.
Right.
We as people in general, I as a physician in particular, don't tell those people, well, you know, you're still smoking, so I'm not going to deal with you. You know? That's not the way you try to do the best you can regardless of whether they smoke or not. Now, if they ask you, and sometimes even if they don't, you may bring up the subject, you know, smoking isn't good for you.
Right.
I would particularly bring that up with people who are adolescents and who still have perhaps the ability to escape this. But, you know, somebody's been confirmed for 50 years and they're decided they're going to die with a cigarette between their lips. Hey, I'll do the best I can for them. And, you know, I'm not going to try to beat them over the head because there's no point to it. Besides that, it's not the smoking that's the problem.
Mm-hmm.
You know, such as it is, it's a separation from God that's a problem.
Mm-hmm.
Smoking goes away if you can get that fixed.
Right.
And the final thing is that, you know, you may not be able to fix these people. Then,
well, you can't.
Then quit trying. You know, accept them the way they are, love them the way they are. The one thing that I don't think we can do is, in order to make them feel better, to say, well, smoking really doesn't matter, because it does.
Right.
And that's one reason why, I don't know whether you want to draw the line at going to a gay wedding or not, right. but I think that there needs to be somewhere the ability to draw the line and say, you know, the original plan was male-female.
Right.
It's the best plan. Homosexuality is
right.
falling out from the ideal. And, you know, after that, you make your choice, and
right.
you live with it, and we live with it, and we do the best we can with whatever you do.
Right.
I saw a nice recent video that made a good point. The Christian community needs to act Christian toward these individuals, and sometimes in a political environment, we have done less than that, and there's no excuse for us not being careful and loving and kind to these individuals. But I agree with you, that does not mean we promote or condone it, but that doesn't mean that they're any worse than we are.
Right. They just have a different distortion than we do, and so it's, you know, a matter of everyone has their own sins, basically. Yeah, a lot of the Bible thumping over the head seems to be the devil in disguise, as I pointed out in the last slides there. So,
just to add to his, You know, Jesus, with the woman that was brought, accused of adultery, Jesus said, go and sin no more. So that's the same idea. I was thinking about the recent court ruling, and some of the southern states are really dragging their feet, and one of us abolished, is not going to issue marriage licenses to anybody now.
That solves the problem. It's not the ideal thing, but that's the best thing we got.
And I heard a one woman quoted, or no, she was actually saying, she was in the court, I don't know, she was partly responsible for issuing marriage licenses, and she said she could not conscientiously do it.
Right, and so she resigned. Actually, it was because...
I guess that's your only choice.
I just saw this before I left this morning. There was an article where, it was last night maybe, it was something to do with, I think it was Tennessee, the entire county clerk board, there was no gay marriage licenses because the entire board resigned all at once. And it was kind of like...
Amen to that.
I mean, if that's what they want to do is upturn all of society in the process, then go ahead and see if they like the results, because it's the fault in this is going to get real messy, and there's going to be lots of angry people on their hands.
You wonder how far this is going to go if you refuse. I don't know. If a person refuses to...
It's already a free-for-all. I mean, remember the other gentleman mentioned that...
People who are conscientiously opposed to it and don't want to, say, photograph, if they're hired as a photographer for a wedding, that's, you're a catering or, you know, they'll be homophobic.
Well, that's what I mentioned. They call everyone homophobic who disagrees. Like it doesn't mean anything anymore. It used to be, you know, people who actually hated or feared gays, like, say, the Westboro Baptist Church, and now it's just if you happen to have a disagreement, they'll have a temper tantrum. And think about like a little child saying doo-doo head when you don't like, you know, they're angry, they get angry at someone, they call them doo-doo head. And that's basically all it is. It's leftists crying doo-doo head.
Well, the dog is wagging, and the tail is wagging the dog, you see. And all this, I think, is leading to something. Is the pendulum is going to swing the other way. And it's going to be told, thus said the Lord, you must do the way we tell you to do. And that's when Revelation chapter 13 comes to play, when no man can buy or sell. I think it's coming. It's here.
Interesting.
I think it's coming.
Yeah.
Out of chaos comes control.
Right, right. It leads to complete chaos. I'm actually wondering at the end of this, like, you know, say 10, 20 years from now, I mean, you know.
That may not be that far.
Maybe just 5, 10 years from now.
Yes.
There's going to be people getting really angry at, you know, left-wing extremists and atheists and so on, and the people who've been pushing this whole time. So
it's coming. It's coming. And I believe that just before it happens, the Lord is going to make it sure that his character is known, that it's known by people can make a choice, black and white.
Right.
I think that's coming. And he's going to use very ordinary people. Daniels and Josephs and Moses. I think we're going to see this. Esther, we're going to see this happen very quickly. Very quickly.